Model, TV presenter and former Miss Northern Ireland, Zoe Salmon has a metabolism to die for. Throughout her life, she's eaten pretty much what she wants and has never got fat.
Perfect.
How very annoying. Zoe's 5'7" and a healthy weight. But as she hits her 30s, even she has to watch her diet.
Unfortunately, in the industry that I work in, weight seems to be a massive issue.
More likely to be seen on the red carpet than in the frozen food aisle of her local supermarket, Zoe eats only the finest food with her famous friends.
Can I have the sirloin, please? Can I have it rare?
And when she's at home, she likes nothing more than a large stuffed crust pizza on the sofa. But even Zoe can't keep eating this many calories forever. So we're taking away the junk food and the gourmet dinners and putting her on a low-fat diet.
You got me begging you for mercy.
For 4 weeks, she'll eat nothing but pre-packaged foods that are labelled low or lower in fat.
Can't wait to taste it all and see what it's like.
The low-fat food industry is worth billions in the UK, with more reduced-calorie ready meals sold in January than at any other time of the year. Basically, we can't get enough of them. But is a life of quick, convenient, low-fat foods going to be any life at all? And crucially, will Zoe lose any weight?
I just feel really gassy and really big and really uncomfortable. Terrible for the bowels, absolutely terrible.
And while Zoe gets well acquainted with the contents of her freezer compartment, we'll also be meeting the low-calorie converts who say eating this way isn't just a diet, it's a way of life.
It's like a guilt-free pleasure.
It's scary to know that there's only one thing that I eat.
We'll find out how these low-fat alternatives can affect our moods, our hunger and our energy levels.
With this, I just eat, 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 eat.
And whether it's a celebrity diet that could ever catch on.
Are you going to carry on with this diet?
OMG.
Now, is this some sort of joke? OMG.
Zoe Salmon, former Blue Peter presenter, reality show Ice Queen and cover girl, is about to take on one of her toughest challenges yet. In her line of work, image matters, so she wants to know if Britain's diet food industry will make a difference to how she looks.
Standard, where's my low-fat ready meals?
It's such a huge experiment, and it's pretty unpredictable what it's going to do to me and how my body is going to react.
Right, okay.
I worry about what it's going to do to my nails, my skin, my hair, my weight.
So weird, I've never even been in this section before, like ever.
You know, one minute they're printing on the front covers of magazines, these people are too skinny, then the next it's they're too fat. It is a worry that perhaps on this diet I may lose weight or gain weight. And certainly, you know, it's going to be tricky to then get back on track to what weight I was before.
Part of the chocolate snack-a-jack.
I'm quite a simple girl in what I eat, and I do just like my fruit, my veg, my rice, my meat, my fish. I love my desserts. So to come off all of that and to go into a purely processed food environment, I can't imagine that that's going to be great for my health.
With a freezer full of TV dinners, Zoe heads to Harley Street for her first appointment with nutritional consultant Alice Sykes. Alice has a degree in biochemistry and a PhD in adult nutrition, so Zoe couldn't be in safer hands.
What do you think is going to happen to you psychologically and physically, if anything?
Already, I'm freaked out at the loss of control.
Are you worried about what effects this month, this project is going to have on you?
Yeah, it did freak me out because I've done my shopping for the week and because when I do go food shopping, I do love fruit and vegetables, and I love that I can eat something that's healthy and I can make something myself which is simple.
Yeah.
So it freaked me out when there was no fruit and veg there at all.
I think the foods that we're now switching you on to, these so-called diet foods, these light products, I think they're going to have much more of a physiological effect on you.
This is why I'm so interested in doing all this filming, because my knowledge of the health food industry is so limited, and I want to know what it really does do to my body.
What I'd like is to do what we call a one test. And what a one test entails is it's a urine analysis. And what we'll be looking at is how these foods affect you in a sort of biochemical layer, so a physiological level. And we'll be looking at your vitamin and mineral status. We'll be looking at how it affects your liver, because that is a major thing. And I know you have to drink a lot of alcohol doing what you do.
Yeah, it's going to be one heck of a month. Absolutely. Bring it on. We'll see what happens. Hello.
It's only the first day of her new eating regime, but already Zoe's stamina is being tested.
It smells so good.
Tonight, her friends are getting together for wine and pizza, but as she's not allowed to enjoy one, then why should any of her guests?
Okay, so all my friends have obviously put their pizza orders in. I've got them. But what they don't know is that just before I give them the pizzas, I'm going to write on the top of the boxes their name with their pizza and how many calories, how many grams of fat, how many grams of sugar, and how many grams of salt are in each one.
Domino's put the nutritional values of all their pizzas on its website, so you can be fully informed of the calories and fat content in each one, if you can be bothered to look. And if it doesn't give you indigestion, then I don't know what will.
Okay, that is the nutritional value all explained, and I hope they enjoy their pizzas and I haven't put them off their food at all. Hey guys, here comes the pizza dude. Okay, I've got all your names from the inside. See which one is yours.
What?
That's what you're eating, guys.
That's yours. Look at the calories.
64 grams of fat, Greg. You fat. 38 grams of fat in the margarita pizza. That's really scary.
That's a lot of Pilates, Claire.
Despite the scary calories in theirs, it's Zoe's pizza that seems to be getting the most attention.
Look what I have. I had to get two because this is one portion. So basically I've got this for two people, being just me.
That's a starter.
I know, can you believe it? It's not even a starter, it's like a pre-starter. I predict that after eating both of these, I'm just gonna be so hungry still. Because let's face it, as we all know, when I have a pizza, I do have a full one like you guys. So this is just gonna make me hungry. So I can't really say that I'm gonna enjoy this, especially looking at all of yours, but.
With only half a gram of fat and 220 calories per pizza, Zoe is definitely making the low-fat choice here. Although she is eating two, because, well, have you seen the size of them?
Look, I think I'll just have another glass of wine. Join my sorrows. Bon appetit, everyone. Enjoy your highly calorific, delicious pizzas.
Zoe's learning fast that keeping things small is just one of the secrets of low-fat foods. With portion sizes this minuscule, is it any wonder she's been grazing all day just to stay satisfied?
I had one packet of Snacker Jacks, and I thought, right, I'll have this, and, you know, that's grand, that'll do me for an hour. So I literally had one, and within the space of an hour, I had another two packets. Like, that's ridiculous. I mean, who eats three packets of Snacker Jacks in a row? I mean, everything so far is just really, really bland. It just doesn't taste very nice, so that means that you're constantly compensating and overeating to find some sort of nice taste and to find something that's satisfying and going to fill you up. But nothing does. You're just constantly eating. Am I going to survive? Eat a lot of E-numbers. Is that going to make me a little bit crazy?
Probably. Taxis! The results of the nutritional tests Alice did on Zoe have shown she's deficient in B vitamins found in the likes of green vegetables and dairy products, and has low levels of the antioxidants that can protect her from chronic diseases. So, could this new diet of low-fat, so-called healthy food, be just what the doctor ordered? Day two of Zoe's low-fat experiment starts with a bowl of Special K.
Breakfast is a good place to start to think about how much salt and sugar that we're eating. A breakfast cereal, for example, could have no sugar or salt added. It could be a really important source of whole grains, which are important for cancer prevention and heart health, but it could be completely opposite. It could be full of sugar and full of salt, so it's really worth checking.
Enjoy a low-fat cereal.
Cereals such as Special K have a healthy image and are marketed as an answer to our weight loss prayers. What other product boasts its own diet and a little red dress?
set this party season alight.
Thousands swear by the Special K diet, so much so it's the fourth most recognised in the UK. You'll probably know a dropper jean-sized disciple. Doesn't every office have them? They'll be the ones religiously eating bowls of milk and cereal in the staff canteen while you're tucking into a plate of pie and mash. But for some people, the Special K weight loss plan isn't so much a two-week wonder diet, more a way of life.
My name is Charlene and I'm addicted to Special K.
When it comes to obsessive cereal eating, Charlene Gajadhar is a cereal offender.
Special K comes in, ranks quite highly in my life. It's,
above me.
No, it's not. Sometimes.
Charlene's been on the Special K diet not for 2 weeks, but for 7 years. She started eating the cereal after piling on the pounds. Two of her three meals a day have been Special K ever since.
It's scary to know that there's only one thing that I eat. It's not practical, it's...
To be honest, we have had a lot of arguments about it. That's why I've learned a lot about it. After that, you just don't want to argue anymore. So you just come to terms with it, I suppose.
While Charlene leaves her Special K to soak for 15 minutes, she rustles up a roast dinner for her boys.
Smells nice.
Eating out is not an option, and neither of them can remember the last time they sat down for a romantic meal together.
I don't know, honestly, I don't know.
I can't remember. Sometimes it's hard for me to sit at the table and eat with them and look at what they're eating and not feel like you want to eat it as well. I don't like people looking at me. I don't like any interruptions, any distractions. It has to be just me and my cereal. And I know it sounds really stupid, but if I didn't take that time to sit down and eat the cereal slowly, properly, and actually taste what I'm eating, then half an hour later, I'll be starving again.
I would have thought that women had, you know, wine and dine me and whatever, take me out every night. And this is the first woman that I'm meeting that I'd want to do that for. And she's like, nah, let's stay in. I want to eat my Kellogg's. I'm like, oh, okay. Not really.
Charlene takes her Special K everywhere.
Panic is the word, panic. You know, even if I'm going down to London, I will still take it, I'll have it in the boot, and I'll make sure I have 2-3 packs of milk and 2-3 packs of cereal.
The times that we did go on holiday, she was a pain, just because she didn't have her cereal, to the point where I would have walked on my elbows to go and get her it, just to keep her quiet. I'd say there were 3 people in our marriage. Not like that, but, you know.
Right.
I'm going to get punched now. Listen, what I'm saying is that, yes, we do have to incorporate Special K into our marriage and into our relationship and into our everyday life.
Yes, definitely.
And it's put me off cereal for my life.
Special K says this diet is only a quick-fix weight loss booster and not a long-term healthy eating plan. It may be low in fat, but it's high in sugar. So high, in fact, that the consumer organisation Which found that starting the day with a bowl of Special K and semi-skimmed milk will give you more sugar than a bowl of supermarket own brand ice cream.
Reviewing Charlene's diet, it is very restrictive and it has been for quite some time, which has put her at risk of nutrient deficiencies. For example, it's her fibre intake is pretty low. Now, this can put you at risk of bowel disease, bowel problems, and increase your risk of certain cancers.
Our guinea pig dieter Zoe Salmon isn't showing any signs of replicating Charlene's Special K obsession.
There we go, closing third. Ready to go?
However, she is noticing that she's always eating because the low-fat foods aren't satisfying her. So perhaps it's not the best time to be doing a photo shoot for a lads mag.
So we are en route to the cover shoot. yay, exciting times. Do forgive the dark glasses, but late night plus no makeup equals not good for your eyes, so excuse the shades.
For breakfast, it's a Tesco Lighter Choice cereal bar.
So it's a chocolate and orange cereal bar. Sounds quite delicious, but apart from the fact it is tiny and about the same size as my baby finger, it's really laden with sugar. 5.2 grams, 1.3 of fat, 80 calories. But the thing is, I'd want to have a few of those, if not the whole box. In fact, I literally do think that I could eat all six of those. That's ridiculous, they're so small. This whole container has 23 grams of sugar, so high in the old sugar front. Who would have thought that that has more sugar than a cereal bar?
So in Zoe's breakfast, there's a combined total of just over 28 grams of sugar. So that's about a third of her recommended daily sugar intake. And it's not even 9 o'clock in the morning yet.
Where are the toilets? Are we going?
Hello.
Hello, gorgeous.
Very apologies for the delay. Good to see you. You're good, thank you.
You were?
Yeah, good.
I'm so used to, you know, if I'm hungry, snacking on, I don't know, like a banana or, I don't know, nuts, and maybe if I cook at home, eating vegetables and rice and getting some fresh fish or meat. Yeah. And I can't do any of that. So I've just got to eat what they give me. Hello.
Do you want anything to eat?
There's a question. Well, first of all, is it low, lower, or less fat?
I've got measly, yogurt, fruit, and croissants.
Oh, do you know what? I'd love any or all of the above, especially the fruit, actually.
Like,
but I'm not allowed any of them.
So what are you going to eat for lunch?
Everyone's going to think I'm mental.
Nice.
Ooh,
come and get your some, come and get your some. Really sexy looking. Yeah, nice, great, nice.
At lunch, she avoids the rather tasty looking buffet and tucks into a pre-prepared quiche she brought with her.
This is a bacon and leek quiche. Actually looks all right. It's quite appetizing. Let's see what's in it. A reduced fat smoked reformed bacon and leek quiche. Reformed bacon. Do you know what it is? It's the texture of it. The texture isn't nice. They all look exactly like the same piece. They're all identical. Oh, like they've been made in the same little factory and cut up into the same little squares. I really should stop playing with that and just face fact that I'm not gonna eat it.
Low calorie and low fat, but the pieces of reformed ham in Zoe's lunch are as teeny weeny as her FHM bikini.
Reformed ham is made using pieces of meat and water all bound together in a form that makes it look like it's been cut directly from the bone. Now, the advantage of this is that for manufacturers is that it has consistent nutritional properties in terms of the calories, the quantity of fat in each piece, but also it keeps the costs down.
The photo shoot is over, but the day is not done for Zoe, who's due at a film premiere in London's West End in less than an hour. She fuels up on low-fat chocolate snack bars, but steers clear of the vitamin water drink she had for breakfast.
I did notice that both those vitamin-esque waters had a lot of sugar in them. And I think I was quite shocked because I think that you expect to taste that from, you know, a diet soda. But I would say that the diet sodas that I drink taste much less sugary.
Image is everything, but the flavoured water market is a good example of a product with a healthy image that doesn't always match the reality.
Bye! See you later.
Twice in the last 2 years, Coca-Cola has been forced to pull some of its advertising for vitamin water because of misleading claims made about the drink's health benefits. This water also got its knuckles wrapped for failing to mention that some of its flavours contain up to 42 grams of sugar. So, how do these so-called healthy H2Os compare with our favourite fizzy stuff? The UK guzzles more than 5,000 million litres of carbonated drinks every year, 37% being low calorie. And there's a certain diet drink that we just can't get enough of.
My name's Rachel and I'm addicted to Diet Coke. No, mummy's Tash.
Rachel Podmore lives in Greater Manchester. She started drinking Diet Coke as a student because she wanted to watch her weight. She now drinks more than 2 litres of the black stuff a day, every day.
It's funny, they look like little bits of Rice Krispie in that.
Zoe's come to meet Rachel, but she's so hungry on this 4-week eating regime, she's even taken to munching on cereal during interviews.
How long can you go before you have another drink of Diet Coke after you've just had one?
Not very long, to be honest. It's like I said, if in the morning I have my glass of Diet Coke and we go out, I will have to go to the shop and make sure that I've got a little bottle of Diet Coke in my bag, because I know that I'll get to the top of the street and I want something to drink. And I do try and buy a bottle of water, but I'll buy a bottle of water and a bottle of Diet Coke because I know that the water's just not going to fix it. It's like a guilt-free pleasure.
The amount that Rachel's having does concern me greatly. We have ADIs, or acceptable daily intakes, in the UK for sweeteners. And I think that the amount that she's having, she is exceeding this. The other ingredients in the drinks as well, things like caffeine, citric acid, which can erode the enamel on your teeth, things like phosphoric acid can affect your bone health. My advice to Rachel would be she certainly needs to cut down.
The FSA actually say that really you shouldn't be having any more than 14 cans a day. Do you ever exceed that or worry about it?
I would hate to add up how much we actually drink in a day, because I've got a funny feeling it would go well over 14 cans a day. But you drink it out of a bottle and you don't think it's anything. The bottle goes and goes, that went really quick, and you don't think anything of it.
The Food Standards Agency's guidelines exist because of the sweetener, aspartame, possibly the most controversial food additive in history. 200 times sweeter than sugar, studies have linked it to everything from depression to brain tumours. But other studies have concluded that there are no adverse side effects, and Coca-Cola insists that aspartame is safe to drink.
My plan was that once I'd had Benjamin, that I'd stop, and that would be enough. I wouldn't drink any more Diet Coke, but it's easier said than done, especially when you drink as much as I do.
Because Diet Coke contains artificial sweetener, it can keep its calorie content low. But there's research which suggests that drinking low-cal fizzy drinks actually makes you eat more, which, if correct, rather defeats the object, doesn't it? So, with the help of 30 strapping lads from a Manchester rugby club, Zoe wants to put this theory to the test. Research psychologist Dr. Catherine Appleton is the woman behind the experiment. She's been studying the effects of low-sugar drinks on our calorie consumption for 10 years.
We think it's because thin sugar, sweetness and energy are associated together. So when you consume a sweet taste, your body is expecting energy to come after it. With an artificially sweetened drink, however, you experience the sweet taste, but you don't experience the energy, of course, because there is no energy in a diet drink. Consequently, your body expects the energy. It doesn't receive it, so you feel hungrier and you tend to eat more.
We've split the players into two teams. After training, one team will drink a selection of full-sugar colas and juices. The other team will drink low-sugar, low-calorie versions of the same drink.
Okay guys, so you all know what teams you're in and what drinks you should be getting from what table. Great, so you're the red team, are you the blue team?
Yeah.
Excellent. Okay guys, well listen, come on in, follow me. So first team over here, second team over here, drink as much as you like.
After drinking as much as they can, both teams will then eat as much as they can from these tables, which have the same food with exactly the same calorific values. we've asked them to write down everything they eat so we can count up the calories at the end of the night. Will Catherine's theory be right? Will the players who drank the low-sugar drinks eat more? We'll find out tomorrow morning when Catherine's had time to do the maths.
So I've just received an email from Catherine. She sent through the results from last night's experiment. And guess what? She was right. The players who drank the low-sugar drinks ate more calories than those who drank the full-sugar drinks. Actually, about 142 calories more per person. Unbelievable. So full fat, successful results there. I can't wait to tell my best friend Nicola. She lives on diet soda drinks. Unbelievable. Hi, Damien, how are you?
Zoe's on the move again. This time she's in Belfast. But leaving London doesn't mean she can leave behind her diet. Tonight she'll host the Glamour Awards.
So it's another morning with breakfast on the go. Today I've got a very special packet of mini bricks. Special K, there you go. It's got a lot of Chinese in the back, but in between that, it does make some sense.
But Zoe's finding that there's nothing glamorous about a month living on pre-packaged low-fat foods.
Oh my goodness.
I mean, it's hard to think that actually putting water into it is actually going to help me out here.
Are you not enjoying this diet?
Actually, to be honest, no. And I don't actually know how I'm going to survive the month because this is only in my first week and I'm feeling so lethargic and my stomach just feels so bloated. As if I've been eating non-stop all day and I haven't even had my dinner yet. I just feel really gassy and really big and really uncomfortable. It feels like my gut and my stomach is just in a big bad mood and it's making me feel a bit sort of, I don't know, just a bit down. And it's actually made me appreciate my diet beforehand. Like I must have been relatively healthy because I was always just in a happy, healthy mood about the way my, you know, body was feeling, but my body just feels completely out of sorts. I wonder who's doing the Dean's hair and makeup.
But being a true pro, Zoe perks up for the red carpet and looks radiant in red. Inside, she has a special request for the maitre d'.
Would you mind heating up this sip for me and serving it to me in a bowl? I'm just at that table there.
Sorry, madam, I haven't made a problem at all.
Is that okay, really? Oh, amazing! Brilliant! Good, okay, well, I'll just see you over there. I'll be waiting with my spoon. Great! Fantastic! Love it!
So now he thinks she's a diva with an eating disorder because everyone else is enjoying the fabulous food. Even Nadine Coyle's eating it, and she lives in LA.
The way I'm feeling at the minute isn't great, to be honest. I feel very uncomfortable still, just really sluggish, a bit tired, and just actually feel quite sick. I definitely have some sort of a cold coming on. My throat is really sore. You know when you can just feel it coming in your nose and your head? And again, I actually haven't had a cold in about a year. No joke.
The level of this.
Back in London, Zoe's in Harley Street for her second appointment with nutritionist Alice Sykes. A specialist in digestive disorders and weight loss, Alice is monitoring the effects of these foods on Zoe's body.
It's so weird because this is probably the worst ever diet that you could give to someone like me.
Mm.
And of course, I didn't realise it until I'm now, you know, on day 7 of it. I think I'm constantly grazing on things to push me through.
I was about to say, one of the reasons why you're probably not getting the ups and downs is because you're eating all the time now.
Yeah.
Which brings me on to the next question. How has your hunger been? What's your appetite been like since these 7 days?
I find that, what was the question?
Hunger.
Yeah. It just goes to show you how this is affecting my brain because when I asked earlier on what was the question,
yeah.
I can't even think straight anymore.
That's interesting because that's fat, the lack of fat in a diet. And fat you know, despite all its bad press, is actually very good for you. You cannot have a working brain without these fats. And there are different types of fat, but things like the polyunsaturated and the monounsaturated fats, we actually need them. We need them for every cell in our body. We need them for hormones. We need them for absolutely transport of hormones, absolutely everything. And without them in foods, we don't feel satisfied. So you're just going to end up eating more than you normally would. And yet you're trying to do this to cut back on calories. You know, that's the point of these foods being on the shelf, isn't it?
It's like, what am I doing to myself?
I definitely am noticing a huge difference in just forgetting normal things. I just seem to forget things really easily. And I never did that before.
But the show must go on, and back at the flat, Zoe's next food delivery arrives. She's bored, bored, bored of the blandness of her diet and starts the week down in the dumps at the prospect of doing it all over again.
Oh, it's just getting quite depressing because I've always loved my food, always been a real food fan and a real foodaholic. So to be nearly halfway through this and to have spent so long eating all these foods that are just making me feel bloated and tired and, you know, affecting my mood so that I am having these mood swings, and with the sugar highs and lows, you're feeling up and down and just feeling really lethargic, and oh, it's just getting more and more frustrating that there's just nothing nice to eat.
Dinner time. Let's see, what shall I treat myself to? So funny, because when I first started eating these, obviously a matter of days ago, I hate the way there's water in it from the defrosting. It's like, I don't want watery food. Ooh, can I drain that without losing any of it? Oh, that's disgusting. There's so much water comes out of that. Like, I really don't want that water in my food. It would, like, be a broth. But when I first started eating these the other day, it didn't occur to me to even take it out of the container. I was eating it from the container and it just looked awful. And you can actually put it on a plate and make it look a bit pretty. All about the presentation, because it's certainly not about the taste. It's really not about the taste.
Talking to Alice earlier in the week about fat and why it's needed in our food has made Zoe start thinking about what must go in when the fat stuff comes out. She's hoping food technologist Simon Wright might have the answers.
I want to start off by talking about an ingredient called methylcellulose. Now, this is a very commonly occurring ingredient in products which they're trying to reduce the calorie content. And it's used as a thickener, it's used as a stabiliser, it's used as an extender, so it's a way of reducing the energy density of common foods. And in this product, there's actually three different types of cellulose here. There's ordinary cellulose, there's hydroxypropyl methyl cellulose, and there's sodium carboxymethyl cellulose. And the reason there are different sorts of cellulose is that you've got in this product, you've got a bun, you've got a cream filling, you've got a chocolate coating. So the food industry has designed different types of cellulose to work in different components. If you actually make up the methylcellulose in water, you end up with this really sticky paste, which looks a bit like wallpaper paste, which is not surprising because one of the active ingredients in wallpaper paste is methylcellulose.
Wallpaper paste? Did he really just say that?
So here, we've got some wallpaper paste. And I'm going to stick up a bit of wallpaper. Okay, so wallpaper paste, wallpaper. Beautiful. Sticks nicely. So this is a solution of methylcellulose in water that we made earlier. And I'm going to use it to stick some wallpaper.
If you can really stick wallpaper with that. I mean, imagine what that is doing to the inside of your body.
Here's the acid test.
And Zoe's reaction?
I actually think this is a better finish.
Okay, so the wallpaper thing is a bit hideous, but methyl cellulose is a perfectly safe, approved ingredient. The ingenuity of the modern food industry knows no bounds, but it gets far more bonkers than this.
In this loaf of bread...
Yes.
..is an ingredient called E920.
OK.
L-cysteine. L-cysteine is what's called a flour improver, so it helps the loaf grow to its right height, and it's made from duck feathers. That's just in Europe. In China, apparently, it's extracted from human hair.
No.
So I think we've got off quite lightly.
Synthetic artificial E920 tends to be used nowadays to keep the vegetarians happy. So no ducks were harmed in the making of this loaf.
Oh, I'll never look at my feather boa again in the same light. Quackers.
Ho, ho.
Quackers.
So taking the fat out of food doesn't make it purer, just more Frankenstein. And Zoe's time in the lab has made her want to learn more about artificial ingredients. She finds a website, weightwatchersmeals.co.uk, where two chefs answer questions from the public.
We've got Rick here with a question for you, Shane.
Are the pies made from a fake pastry?
No, the pies are made from fresh pastry made here on site.
What is best to have to accompany a Weight Watchers meal?
Glass of water is always good.
Glass of water?
Or a side salad, something nice and healthy.
I love that they've just said something nice and healthy should accompany a Weight Watchers meal, therefore insinuating that it's not really that healthy and you need to sort that out. Hilarious.
But some of the comments they make leave Zoe a little confused.
Hi Joanne, what's your question? Can you tell me, are Weight Watchers meals made from artificial ingredients? Over to you guys.
No, there are no artificial ingredients within any Weight Watchers prepared meals.
Not sure I believe that.
No, they didn't really answer the question, did they? Where do the ingredients come from that make up the meals?
All of the ingredients used in Weight Watchers products are commonly available at all supermarkets.
Eh?
All these things are commonly found. You'd need to know what they are before you'd even need to know where to find them. And I didn't even know what most of the things are in these foodstuffs. Crazy.
We called Weight Watchers to ask about the website. They told us it belongs to a company called Greencore, who make many of their ready meals. So we called them.
Oh, hi. Is this Greencore?
It is, yeah.
Hi. I've got a few questions about just something that I've watched on the weightwatchersmeals.co.uk site.
Okay.
On the website, it states that there's no artificial ingredients in the Weight Watchers foods. Is that true?
We don't use any artificial colours, preservatives or flavours, that sort of thing at all.
Mm-hmm.
Basically, anything that's on the back of packets, that's what's in there. We'd have to declare anything that was artificial.
Okay. It's just that in your Weight Watchers meals, in quite a few of them, there's polydextrose and polyphosphates and also triphosphates. Now, I know that they're made in a lab, so how do you then define artificial if they're made in a lab?
I'm just looking at the specification for that actual ingredient, and I think you're correct in thinking it's a manufactured bulking agent. Whether you want to say chemically or in a lab, it's basically made industrially, shall we say.
Should therefore the website not say that there are no artificial ingredients then?
Yeah, no, I see your point on that. I'm no legal expert.
Mm.
What I'd have to do is raise your query with who actually runs the website.
He went on to explain that polydextrose and polyphosphates are already in some ingredients before they reach the factory and are not put in by Greencore. But you can understand why Zoe finds the website's claims of no artificial ingredients more than a little misleading.
If you've got any suggestions again, just go over to the Meet the Chef section and submit any questions there.
I really want to post my own question on this. Like, are you taking the absolute mech?
What date is it then?
It is the 15th, also a very important date.
Why is that?
Because the 15th means that I'm officially halfway through my 30 days of this experiment.
And I noticed some excitement in your voice.
Yes.
So tell me, what's been going on?
Yeah, my bowels just aren't working in the same way.
And what is your is your meaning of that?
Well, just because, you know, I'm used to being healthy and regular and on this diet, I'm not.
Slow and sluggish, body and bowels.
Absolutely.
The number one thing is you have such a lack of fibre in your diet.
Mm-hmm.
There's in fact, I think there's probably about zero.
Yeah.
There's nothing fresh. There's nothing that's got that insoluble fibre that we use to pull our bowel movements through our system.
It's just that, you know, I just feel really bloated and really,
Yeah, absolutely. So you've got a very low-fat diet and you've also got a very, very low-fibre diet. Terrible for the bowels. Absolutely terrible.
So I've just lifted my meal out of the microwave. Look at that. See all that stuff in the corner there? It looks a bit like wallpaper paste or glue or something.
A bit like catsick.
Oh, catsick. That's disgusting. Look, I can see one bit of my 4% of carrots. Oh, look at it. It actually looks a bit... looks quite wobbly.
So how long will a wobbly ready meal like this stick around in the system? We can get a pretty good idea from this man in a white coat who has artificially created the stomach and small intestine under laboratory conditions. We had high hopes of a Frankenstein-like contraption gurgling away, poised to take over the world like some freak artificial stomach alien thing at... Oh. Professor Jeff Pearson from Newcastle University has been given a sample of Zoe's typical daily diet. He's got breakfast, a snack and a low-fat chicken and rice ready meal.
When I looked at the fibre content of some of the things she's eating, and you look at what she might eat in a whole day, she's probably eating 8 to 10 grams of fibre, and the recommended daily allowance is 24. So she's not eating half the amount of fibre that she needs. And I wouldn't be surprised if she isn't suffering as a result of that. I would expect her to be constipated and maybe to have a bloated sensation.
And with this artificial stomach contraption, we can begin to see why that might be. First, you need to replicate the chewing stage, so the food gets crushed up in small pieces. Then, artificial saliva is added to the food with a syringe. The three different foods are then put in three separate containers, or stomachs, and the digestion process begins. But Professor Pearson has already noticed something interesting about the ready meal.
I would say, looking at how easily that the fibres are breaking up from the meat, I wouldn't expect meat to break down that easily. So it would suggest to me that something's being done to it. It's either very young or something in the processing has made it break up much more easily.
After the food has been in the artificial stomach for an hour, artificial bile is added. Well, pig bile anyway. And suddenly the machine becomes a small intestine. Like the human body, it should be 3 hours before the food is properly broken down. But Jeff's noticing that Zoe's low-fat foods are digesting much quicker than less processed alternatives.
One of the problems that we have with the modern diet is you release glucose very rapidly. And there is a belief that this huge swings of blood glucose can lead to late-onset diabetes.
So Zoe's typical daily diet has now been through the artificial stomach and small intestine. Jeff shows us the before and after result, and it's clear to see how much has been digested in a short space of time. No slow release of energy here, just the fast lane to constipation and hunger.
She probably is hungry all the time, so she's probably snacking a lot.
In between meals, I'm just eating and eating and eating. The other night, I just couldn't stop. I mean, from one portion, look how much I've got left. My portion was practically the full ice cream tub for a family of six for a week. I've turned really, really greedy. And I hate it, and it's frustrating because I'd much rather have 3 normal balanced meals and a few snacks and that's it. But with this, I just eat, 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 eat.
To cheer herself up, Zoe treats herself to a noodle salad from a high street coffee chain. It's labelled as low in fat, so we're letting her have it. She then hits the shops for some retail therapy.
Oh, they're a must, aren't they? You know, they'd look really good with my new crayfish salad, wouldn't they? Every girl needs a new pair of shoes to eat her new salad with. This is a celebratory day. This is the only salad I've had in 16 days. Wow. It's a momentous occasion. One needs to celebrate with shoe purchases. Woo! The way
tonight, no regrets. But how much of a healthy choice is a salad? A recent survey of more than 200 salad and pasta bowls sold in supermarket deli counters and coffee shops found that 1 in 10 ready-made salads contain more salt than a Big Mac. Only 6 contained less salt than a packet of crisps. Zoe's spicy crayfish noodle salad from Eat was one of the salads surveyed. With 2.8 grams of salt, it contains half of her recommended daily allowance.
I'm surprised that in a salad there is more salt in this than a Big Mac. I mean, that in itself is quite a strong statement. It's quite tricky to get your head around because you do think of those foods as being the worst, but this is supposed to be a salad. But I suppose taken in the context of the other nutritional value in this, it's obviously a lot lower in saturated fats and sugars than perhaps a Big Mac. But yeah, the salt factor is quite shocking. And it's not going to stop me eating it, to be honest, because it's so nice.
Eat have since told us that they are looking to reduce the salt in their salads to meet government targets on salt levels by 2012.
A high intake of salt can lead to raised blood pressure, which is a major cause of strokes, heart disease. The problem with salt is about 3/4 of the amount of salt we eat is actually in the food we buy, in processed food. So it's important not to add it in cooking and try not to have it on the table.
Zoe Salmon's on a big fat, low fat mission. As a model and TV presenter, too often she finds that image is everything. So she wants to find out what 4 weeks living on pre-prepared low fat foods does to her body. On yet another red carpet, it's another red-faced moment when she's forced to explain her bizarre eating habits to bemused onlookers.
So the lovely meal you have tonight, I won't be able to enjoy
it. Oh, I heard.
I've got my own with
me. You've got your own.
I'm not a diva. I'm not being high maintenance. I'm merely just doing my diet.
We thought you were being a diva and high maintenance.
No, you say
that's what everybody else is saying. That's what the guy at the door said.
Oh, my God. I know, it's so embarrassing because people must just be like, what is she like coming with her own food?
Yeah, what I've got is actually a risotto. So it's just that, if I give you that. And this actually I can eat from the tub. So that just needs hot water and a bowl.
Zoe's getting sick and tired of having to bring her own food to showbiz parties. But at her table, she soon finds a soulmate in Neighbours star Sam Clarke.
I quite literally have been eating this food for the last 2.5 months because we've been on the road. And we actually bought a microwave because we're staying in Travelodge for the entire thing and bringing our microwave in, and this is the only food that we've been able to eat, really.
So you've been eating
I have been eating a lot of
not amazing food. How are you feeling?
I'm feeling tired, constantly tired. But I am working hard at the same time, but, I miss fresh food so much.
Oh, my goodness, it's like you're the male version of me. I miss fruit, I miss vegetables.
And, yeah, I know.
Well, boys and girls, this would appear to be my main course.
At least Zoe's getting some sympathy from the people on her table. Kate from The Apprentice even starts sharing some ready meal anecdotes of her own.
Don't get me wrong, I mean, my mum's given me, like, microwave dinners, and I've bought microwave dinners for myself on more than one occasion, especially when I was a student. And every now and then, it's not going to hurt you, but obviously that can't be your diet day in, day out.
If you put yourself on a diet where you're just eating 100% processed foods, it's not good for you, and that's the bottom line, and that is fact, and I am living proof of the fact that I feel terrible.
After 3 weeks eating nothing but low-fat, highly processed foods, sometimes in public, we thought Zoe deserved a taste of the good life again. Back in Belfast, her besties are waiting for her at one of the city's top restaurants.
Guys, look at you, you're being early.
Hi.
Hi, how are you, Liz?
Grand, thank you.
Cheers. 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 Have you ever read when you eat those convenience foods, those processed frozen food stuff, all the stuff in the back?
She's excited because tonight she can order whatever she likes from the menu. No microwaves, no plastic trays, just fresh seasonal produce.
Could I have the sirloin, please? Could I have it rare?
Well, she thinks she can order what she wants from the menu, but head chef Brian has been given very different instructions.
So here we've got some roast beef, mash, carrots, and broccoli. Fine if you're a single guy at home, you've just come in for work. Does it excite you? No. It's just feeding you. It's not really nice.
Instead of making Zoe's favourite sirloin steak, he'll heat up a beef and vegetable ready meal.
Processed food is so high in salt and everything to stabilise it. So to try and cook something so simple and beautiful, opposed to eating something that's been on the shelf, travelled for 3 days, put in the store, held in your fridge for 3 days, not very nice, not very appealing. Does anybody know what the settings are on this? The reality is, when you get something like this, you know, you would not try and make it pretty at all. There is absolutely no point. There you go. Unfortunately, this girl is going to get this in the packet tonight sent out. There's no way I could try and dress that.
So out it goes, still in its plastic tray.
Or get it from a restaurant, so... Now, is this some sort of joke? Are you... Adam? No, you are joking. No, I really am a lot. Oh my gosh, I'm going to cry. Is it a joke?
Thank you.
Is it a joke?
No.
Am I really not allowed to have the steak? No, hang on. Are you serious?
Yeah.
Oh no. Am I allowed the vegetables?
Well, there's vegetables there. It's a nice...
I've used for really good friends. You would like...
I'll cut you a bit off.
Up. No, oh my gosh, I'm in one of the best restaurants in Northern Ireland. And I can't believe that I'm eating this. OMG.
Taste, it's exciting, it's an experience. You should sit down, enjoy it, and savour every mouthful. It should be exciting, it should be a pleasure. It's your own time, not just about some fuel in the tank.
That's like the biggest slap in the face I've had. Everything you eat is a frustration because you just think this is such a waste of calories. Because you've eaten something and you don't enjoy it, you know it's not good for you. So in many levels, it's just all negativity.
For Zoe, the restaurant stitch-up is the final straw. Thankfully, it's come at the end of her four-week experiment. She may have spent a month feeling lacklustre and narky, but the good news is the diet has actually improved Zoe's B vitamin and antioxidant levels. But what has it done to her weight? Time for her final visit to Alice's clinic on Harley Street.
And obviously, you're at the end. So tell me a little bit, how has it been?
Yeah, It's been a bit of a struggle and a bit of a battle in many ways, but I'm pleased to be sat here today and it is the end of it, so I feel elated to say the very least.
Good. I mean, I told you right at the beginning and you didn't really believe me. I told you it was going to be tough and I knew it was going to be. What's been the hardest thing about this whole process for you?
The hardest thing about this process is definitely the lack of control over what I'm actually putting into my body. It really was different to any diet that I've known of, just to eat processed foods only, to eat everything out of packets, and to cook everything in a microwave is just something that I have never done in my life.
What surprised you the most about the whole process?
I think the thing that shocked me the most is that processed food really doesn't taste that nice. I know what proper vegetables taste like.
Absolutely.
And so when you're eating it in a processed format, it just doesn't taste the same. And I really did notice the difference. And yes, of course, over the 4 weeks, I got used to it, but I still remembered somewhere deep in the back of my mind that really, this doesn't taste like the real deal.
That's right. So I think the big question that we probably all want to know is, did you actually lose any weight going on these so-called diet and low-fat foods?
I certainly have not lost any weight. I have gained weight. In fact, I have managed to put on 3 pounds. Wow. So not ideal. Especially seeing as so many people will think, oh, low-fat foods, diet foods, surely you will have lost weight. No, and it just proves the point that really, if you want to lose weight, don't do it this way. Just eat healthily.
I knew that you wouldn't lose weight. And the reasons I knew that was because these diet foods and low-fat foods have to get their taste from somewhere, because what they're doing is they're taking out the fat. And what they do is they put in sugar and sweeteners. So you're at the end of the 4 weeks. I'm not telling you what to eat anymore. So my question is, are you going to carry on with this diet?
Absolutely not. Are you taking the
OMG.
It's been the best and the worst thing that I've ever done, because obviously the best thing, because I have learnt how bad it is for you.
I would expect you over the next couple of weeks, the 3 pounds that you've gained, you will lose. My belief is that it's probably most of it is just water. So take your time, but I wouldn't get obsessed with the scales. Just go on how you feel. You'll feel less bloated. You'll just, you're just going to feel back to you.
All right. Alice, thank you so much. That's amazing.
No, lovely to meet you.
Zoe started this experiment weighing 9 stone 3. She's now 9 stone 6. So much for her low-fat diet. And to think it started so optimistically.
Can't wait to taste it all and see what it's like.
But enthusiasm soon turned into a downward spiral to lethargy.
I just seem to forget things really easily.
Constipation.
Feels like my gut and my stomach is just in a big bad mood.
And weight gain.
I have managed to put on 3 pounds.
But before she can move on...
1, 2, 3. Woo!
It's goodbye microwave, hello home cooking.
Steamed vegetables, steamed rice, dessert, full-fat chocolate ice cream, and me